Welcome to the digitaltrekker.com. I'm Matt Brandon, and have we got a show for you? So our guest today is Todd White. And I want to know, how does a guy go from tech guru helping people at big corporations get on Zoom and all kinds of other stuff that I'm sure he'll tell us to winning a freaking Emmy? Okay, so we're going to find out how that all works in just right after this. Well, welcome again. I am Matt Brandon, and we have a guest that I have actually met many, many years ago, and his name is Todd White, and Todd is with us in Austin. Hi, Todd. You're on.
Hey, man. How you doing? Good to see you.
Well, yeah, it's good to see you. So we met through Bush, I guess, a mutual friend of ours who is he's like a visual storyteller down in Austin, and I think our first time, and maybe the only time we've actually seen each other face to face, was a cigar and pipe and pints night or something, right? I mean,
was at a place called Hardtails in Georgetown.
Okay,
I remember that.
Yeah, I didn't remember the name of it. That's good that you remember the name of it. But I remember we were smoking some stogies. I had a pipe and quaffing a few brews along the way. It was a good time.
But,
and I keep trying to get you to come up when I'm visiting the temple, but you keep bagging on me, man.
I know. That's all me, man. It's just it's busy, and you know, it's the way it goes.
So this is I'm putting you here to just do a public guilt trip on you right now.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Okay. No, honestly.
And trust me, I've wanted to, because, you know, even before I met you in person, I've always been a fan of your work, and I've always just loved your photography, you know, and you just live in a great place. It's just such a rich cultural experience to go out and to shoot. So even before we met, I was already having that thing of like, ooh, I cannot wait to meet this guy.
Well, thanks. I appreciate that. So, but actually, I think when we met, either you had just got into photography or were about to. You were actually in the tech field. So just a little background. You are currently describing, I guess, yourself, or I can describe you as a brand photographer. So by that, you shoot people's branding, which includes a lot of fashion work. It includes product shots. It includes video work, all kinds of stuff. And I mean, I'm looking at the list here. You've shot Carrie Underwood. You've shot Miranda Lambert. You've shot George Strait. Your work has appeared in Vogue and British Vogue and Elle and People, Wall Street Journal, and a whole bunch of other places. And you've got an Emmy for, what was the Emmy actually for? I know the show was Day Tripper, which is is it a syndicated Texas TV show, or what's the?
It is. So the Day Tripper is a Texas travel show on PBS. So we only film in Texas, and we go around to different cities and towns across Texas, and we've got 30 minutes to tell people, when you go to this location, then these are the things that you should do. And so our host is Chet Garner. He has been doing this for a long time. And we just wrapped up season 11. And I've been on the crew with the crew around, running around since season 4, I believe. So 7 seasons with them.
Okay. And so again, what are you actually doing with them?
And
the
Emmy is for, the actual Emmy is for producing. I've done video work with the crew. There's been a stretch where I did most of the drone work was done by me, and then I shoot all the still photography for the show as well.
Okay, so you're using drones as well. I mean, I'm just adding that into the kit that we can talk about today. So,
crashed a few drones too. I've used them and I've crashed them.
I've only crashed one, but I crashed an Inspire. So. I go big.
Ouch. Yes, you do. You go big, man.
Okay. So anyway, so tell us about your transition into photography. I think a lot of people would be interested in that because I know that there's a bunch of people who are hobbyists, who are semi-pro, and they want to know, how do I make that leap from hobby to getting paid for what I do?
So I started out with photography a long time ago, way back when in the high school days, and I learned on film. So my very first official big camera, I would say, was a Minolta Maxim 7000i 35mm camera. And that's where I started, and had a little Kodak 110 that I threw in the back pocket as well and ran around with, and shot all through high school and had a great time, and then put the camera down and did 26 years in the corporate world. Mm-hmm. And so I worked at USAA in San Antonio, was a tech trainer there, and was the lead tech support for the executive team for them. And then
USAA, the bank?
USAA Insurance in San Antonio, the main insurance company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Yeah. They're my bank. So, anyway.
There you go. Yeah. So, spent about 11 and a half years with them, and then got a little bored and jumped ship, went to Austin, ran through different startup companies, loving the whole tech world, and landed at Cisco Systems and spent some time there. So total time, 26 years in the corporate world. And all throughout that time, though, I sort of did a little photography on the side, but not a whole lot, but dabbled in fun technology. Like this whole live streaming stuff that we're doing. Mm-hmm. Way back at USAA, I dabbled in that when Intel was one of the first players in that and was doing the whole distance learning video conferencing setups with Intel. And we were piloting that at USAA at the time that I was there. And I was on the team that was spearheading that, which was pretty cool.
Really cool.
Which was fun.
Okay. Hey, I want to just encourage people right now, if you're listening to the stream right here on Facebook, be sure to share it. Be sure to, you can even do a house party or a watch party, whatever it's called, watch party, I guess it's called. Do a watch party. It's underneath the share options on your Facebook channel. And then also, if you have a question for Todd, leave it in the questions I think you have to be in the mainstream for me to get the question. But go ahead and leave a question for Todd. And we will pull the question into the frame, and we'll have him answer it and see if we can stump Todd. So, all right. So let's go on. So your impetus was, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to do something that's a lot more exciting and fun and
right.
whatever. And then, so how
there
did
was...
you actually do that leap? I mean, that must have been super scary.
It was. There were two things that had happened. Early on when I was at Cisco, we started going to church at the Austin Stone, and that's where I met Bush and some of the other guys. And like Scott Wade was a really big influence on my career as well, and learned a lot from Scott early on and from Bush and guys like that. And just really started to fall back in love with photography, but I've always shot landscapes and things like that. And so with Cisco, I was sent over to India to launch some new software in one of our call centers. And so I was sent to India for a month. So I got a nice camera and went over to India and thought, I'm just going to go take cool landscape pictures and pictures of the Taj and things like that. And oddly enough, I came back with very few pictures of landscape, but spent most of my time shooting and photographing the people. And that was a really big shift for me, was to move. You can relate.
Yeah.
You can totally relate. And fell in love with the people and the culture and connecting at that point and that level. And that just really sparked that interest for photography for me. And so I came out of that and spent time then with doing mission trips with the Stone, and spent a lot of time traveling and photographing all over the world through those opportunities. And just really fell in love with photography and just kept growing and growing and growing and growing. And I would spend most of my time when I wasn't working, I was shooting and really getting involved with that and helping friends shoot. I would second shoot weddings with Scott and some other friends of mine, and just really enjoyed doing that. And oddly enough, there was a point in time that Cisco was going through a layoff, and I called my boss and I said, I really do not have my heart in the corporate world anymore. It's just not what I find myself doing. And at that time, I'd moved from doing call center management, and I moved over into mergers and acquisitions. And we were in the middle of doing an acquisition at that time, and it was all about the numbers. And so I was on the team that was taking service groups and basically starting to cut people's jobs and shift those to India. And I couldn't do it anymore. It just was, my heart wasn't there, like I said. So I called my boss and told her that I wasn't really into this anymore, would love to make a jump to do something else, and would like to put my name on the list of consideration for the layoff. And so, two weeks later, she called me. Go ahead.
I was gonna say, you virtually had yourself laid off.
I did. So I did that. She called me 2 weeks later and said, I've got good news and good news. You've got your wish and you've got a severance package, and it's been great working with you, and good luck as you pursue your career. Hmm. And you know, so my wife and I, we put our faith in the Lord, and we made the jump. And that was probably around 10 years ago, 9 years ago, roughly, that I did that and walked away from a corporate job and dove full time into freelance photography and have not looked back since then.
Okay. And so how did you get your first gig?
You know, I did what a lot of photographers do when they first start out, and I jumped into the wedding world and started shooting weddings and doing portraits. And then also my daughter worked at a radio station in San Antonio, and so I would start shooting as many live concerts that they had going on there for their radio station. I would start shooting as many of those as I could. So I spent a lot of time shooting at a place called Cowboys Dance Hall in San Antonio. And so that, between live concerts, between weddings, portrait sessions, that's really where I've put my focus. My first year doing photography full time, I shot 43 weddings in 1 year.
43 weddings in 1 year?
43 weddings in 1 year.
That's like a wedding a week. So is that also why you stopped shooting weddings? Because you shot 43
That's also
weddings.
Why I stopped. Yeah, it is. But, you know, at the time, and I began to taper that off, I shot less and less over time. And now I maybe shoot one wedding a year if it's
so
a
you still
friend.
Do weddings.
Like I said, I maybe one a year at the most. I shot one last year in Birmingham, Alabama, for a designer from Project Runway that I knew because I'd shot her collections in Austin a few times. Outside of that, I probably haven't shot a wedding in like a year and a half, maybe, roughly. Mm.
Okay. So. All right. So then how did you actually get, so you're doing this stuff, you've got a gig here and a gig there, but all of a sudden, I mean, your portfolio, I mean, you just name dropped, you know, Project Runway, you've got Vogue, you got Ellie. So how did you skip from being a local, you know, let me shoot for mom's store down the road here to virtually an international portfolio?
It is a lot of hustle. I lived and breathed and ate photography, and just, it's all about networking. It's really about networking. And there are times that I would walk into a situation and I would offer to shoot something for free because I looked to the future and knew that with that connection, that would open other doors and allow other opportunities to happen. So it was a lot of faith, and it was a lot of hustle, and a lot of just really being at the right place at the right time and meeting the right people. Mm-hmm. But all through that too, it was about continuing to grow my craft and grow as a photographer and really stretch myself and how I shot as well. I don't like to be the typical photographer, if you will. I prefer to shoot things differently is where I tend to focus.
Okay, well, we're gonna jump into your a sample of some of your work here in a minute, but I still want to dig into this because I want some to know a couple things. Like, first of all, I know right now in your career that Instagram is huge in what you do. You're on it daily and oftentimes for a long time. I won't say a long time, but you're certainly on it daily. And if you're out on a shoot, you're live streaming the shoot, you're doing all this kind of stuff. Early on, when you say you hustled, was that all from social media? Was it knocking on doors? How did you get contacts with these people that, you know, how do you sell yourself?
It was a combination. So a lot of it was like early on with shooting some weddings. It was going to the venues. It was meeting with the certain wedding planners. And I would look at the venues that I thought were attractive and nice that I wanted to have on my portfolio. And I would reach out to them and ask, how can I get on your preferred photographer list? How do I get my foot in the door with shooting this? When I decided I wanted to shoot fashion, I started paying attention to the boutiques in Austin that had a larger presence, whether they were a chain, but more so carried the brands that were more of a national label and a national brand.
Ah.
And then I paid attention to the fashion industry in Austin and got connected through fashion shows and through events, and then met designers that then worked me to a certain level, like meeting a Project Runway designer named Amanda Valentine. She was early on in the Project Runway seasons, but meeting her and then from there having her make introductions to other designers. And then, you know, now I'm shooting with, you know, either her stuff, or I'm shooting in Dallas or Houston or San Antonio, or I've shot some stuff from Nashville. So there's just been different, it's connections. It's all about making those connections and then fostering those relationships. Very first time I shot for Amanda, we had some spare time. She was a guest designer for a fashion show in Austin. And I texted her and I said, Amanda, if you've got a spare day in the afternoon, I got a couple of models that would love for the opportunity to shoot with your collection. Let's just go collaborate and have some fun. And then from there, a great shoot happened, great portfolio pieces. And then other designers are like, hey, where'd you get those photos? And then she said, oh, Todd took them. And next thing I know, they're calling me. Hey, can you shoot my collection? What are your rates?
So was that a gratis thing that you did with her for your for your portfolio? Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's one thing I think a lot of photographers, especially in travel, a lot of the new guys will take all kinds of gigs for nothing. And I'm always trying to say, don't do it for nothing, but do it strategically. If you're gonna give your services away, do it very strategically. Don't just, oh, you know, here's work, I'm going to go shoot it just to build up my portfolio. I mean, if you're just adding pictures to your portfolio, that's not going to help. You want it to add to someone else's portfolio so that it gets across the pond or wherever.
Portfolio pictures don't pay the bills. They don't. But I will say that just be strategic about it. And a lot of times, and I even did this recently with, there's a nonprofit that's here in town and that I wanted to work with. And instead of saying I'm shooting for free, I've shot with them before for paid opportunities. They've had some changes. They've grown some. And so I called up the lady that runs it and I said, hey, I really think you guys need a refresh on some of your photos for your site. And y'all just got a new building. Y'all have just been through this whole COVID thing. Let me gift you this site refresh on these new products and get that site back up and running for you guys in with the new content. Because I know things are a little tight right now. And on that, then she said, that would be fantastic. That's great. Let's do it. Oh, in 6 months from now, I need a fresh video. I want to hire you to do that. So it's strategy and it's really, and meeting people where they're at, knowing that that'll come back to you.
Right. Yeah. Okay. one of the most fun shoots you've ever been at. Do you have a recollection of that? One that was just like, oh my gosh, this was just so much fun. I'd love to do this again, or you know. I'm sure there are a lot of them that are fun.
There are a lot of them.
Yeah.
That's a tough one. That's a tough one. I'll tell you my first fashion show that I shot with Fashion X in Austin.
Okay.
And it's Fashion X Fashion By, because they've done shows in Houston and Dallas and so on. That was probably one of my funnest experiences because it was fresh and it was new. And I still get super excited about shooting fashion shows. They're always just so much fun. They really are. Just the energy, shooting backstage, the prep, the hair, the makeup, the last minute preparations, the excitement of the runway. There's just really something about that just really feeds that energy, which is wonderful. And then I also really love shooting with an organization called the Sanctuary Project. And that's an organization that's here in the Austin area. And they are an organization that does jewelry. And a portion of their proceeds go to support women that are coming out of the sex trafficking industry. And so it's a really cool story and a really cool ministry part of that. And so last year they hired me to do a full-on portfolio shoot for them for a lookbook. And that was just so much fun to have that connection with the models that I brought in, the hair and makeup team. Everybody was totally on board with the mission and the story, and it just was an amazing collaboration. It was more than just a fashion shoot. There was a story to tell, and that was exciting.
Okay,
that was exciting.
Well, I tell you what, let's jump in. Let's jump into some of your portfolio here, and there was way too many pictures to be able to show everything, but I've handpicked some. You've sent me some, and so let's look at some of these things. All right, so there's the button. All right, here we go. So this is really a colorful set here. So can you give us the backstory on this and tell us about this?
Yeah, there was a Coco Coquette is a wig designer in the area in Austin, and she had an amazing set of new wigs with colors and stuff that she wanted to have shot. So at the time, I partnered with a stylist. Her name was Erin Bradley. She worked for Fashion X at the time, and so we went and grabbed a couple of models here, brought in a hair and makeup team. And really, with the colors that were in this collection of wigs, we really wanted to make those pop. And so we chose colors for each of the background sets that were in contrast with the wigs and the makeup and stuff that we were shooting. The wardrobe is also very tame in this. If you look at it, we really wanted the wigs and the makeup to stand out for this shot, or for this whole collection that we shot.
Okay.
This was one of probably 50 images that came out of that shoot.
Okay. And then
this is Demi that you're showing. This was purely me calling Demi and saying, hey, I've got an idea. I want to do some one light work and would love to shoot with you. She's a model that I've shot since she was, I think, 17 or 18 years old. And she's with a modeling agency called Mazza. And that's a small boutique agency here in Austin. And so she and I got together. We had a stylist that I've worked with before named Joelle. And she pulled from, I think it was Dylan Wilde is where we pulled the wardrobe from for this particular shoot. And we brought in the hair and makeup artist again for this. And we just really, I created a series of one light shots with her featuring multiple sets of wardrobe. It was all about just that whole one light setup.
Now isn't that her again?
Yep. That's her again. Mm-hmm. Different look. We actually shot this at a venue up in Georgetown called Pearl Snap. And it is an old church that's been converted to a wedding venue. And so we had set up the one light area with backdrops. And then this was a shot that I actually took this. I don't know if you can tell it on this. But I shot this on film. There was a series of them that I pulled out my old Hasselblad and shot for this. Was it Hasselblad? No, I used my Pentax. Sorry. I used my Pentax 6.7 for this shot. And so hence why it's by the window.
That's beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Now, here's a series that we've got here. I think there are like three shots here. Super colorful. Mm-hmm. You don't stick. I mean, you're hard to box. I mean, because it's like you've got these dramatic low light stuff. You've got stuff in the street. You've got this kind of stuff, which is stunning. But I mean, just the polar opposite of what we just saw.
Mm-hmm. I like diversity. And that's one thing for me when I'm shooting is I don't like to just be one type of photographer. And I'm going to make this statement and I don't want to offend anybody, but you know, when people say that they're a natural light photographer and that's all they do, that's great. But then, and that's what I did initially. And that's what I started out as, but there's a whole set of commercial work that I do, which is probably 50% of my business, which is stuff like what you're seeing on the screen that I needed to go learn how to use light, how to modify that light, how to do one and two and three light setups and so on. And oddly enough, this was a shot that I requested to do. It was not on our shot list from the designer. So this is from a shoot with a jewelry designer named Susanna Day. And Susanna Day draws her inspiration for her jewelry from her travels. So she spends a lot of time all across Asia, India, different continents traveling. And then she brings back ideas for that. And so hence all the colors. And I just really thought it'd be fun to take an earring and put it in Tiffany's mouth and just shoot it in a very different way. Mm-hmm. And that's where that came from. People often joke about it and say it looks like she has a blue bonnet in her mouth, which I guess it does kind of look like that. But that wasn't obviously in my thought pattern.
That's
through this.
Definitely a Texas comment. The rest mm-hmm. of the world wouldn't even know mm-hmm. what a blue bonnet was. So
exactly. Exactly. But we wanted to shoot the blues of the earrings. And so we have the ones that are in her ears. And then we needed to put that other one somewhere. And I was like, let's put it in her mouth.
So how much of your work is done between studio and location type stuff?
I would say that it is probably, it varies, but usually right around 60-40 outdoors, 40% in studio. And I have some clients that do both. So Susanna Day being one of them, we have shot stuff in the studio before. And then we've also gone and we've shot it outdoors. Another one of my clients is a Steo boutique in Austin. And we do white backdrop, seamless website, e-commerce stuff. And then we also shoot lookbooks that we do outdoors as well in a variety of different places.
Now, given the fact that you're all right. Hey, we got some questions here. So cool. Joe Ramirez says, Todd, what was the camera you brought to India with you?
Wow.
Do you remember?
I want to say, I think that was a Canon 60D, maybe. I think that's what it was.
Because this was a long time ago, right? I mean, that was...
This was many years ago.
Yeah. And now you're like a Lumix global ambassador, right?
Mm-hmm. I am.
Lumix.
I am.
Okay.
We can definitely come back to that comment if you want.
Okay. And then John Rockwood says, Todd, where did you go to learn?
I hung out with people that were great photographers and I learned from them. And so I mentioned early on that people like Scott Way is a really good friend of mine, taught me a lot. Stephen Bush as well is a really great friend, learned a lot from him. And then also just play. I love to play. I'm kind of a gear nerd. I love testing gear. I love playing with light. I like playing with cameras. And I'm always asking the what if. That's really a big thing for me is I'm always asking the what if. Mm-hmm. And I break a rule sometimes where they say don't ever try new things when you're doing client work. but sometimes the opportunity presents itself and it's the perfect time. And so I typically break that rule on shoots also with clients, mm-hmm. but I usually do that when I know for a fact we have what we need covered, mm-hmm. and then I play.
So I'm looking at right now the other shot here of this model, and you've got the who was this your idea? How much of this creative input is there on a shoot like this? Because I'm sure the client has input. There's got to be, if you're working for a magazine, there's going to be an art director sitting there, and then you've got your ideas. Is there too many, too many chefs in the kitchen, so to speak?
You know, every client and every shoot is a little bit different. So with this shoot that we've been looking at with Susanna Day, mm-hmm. She has a very clear vision. She knows what she wants. She brings a printed mood board with her. Mm-hmm. And she goes through that with the makeup artists. And for me, it's really about lighting, backdrops, and execution of the shot.
Okay. So,
But I have other clients like Estio Boutique that says, here's the wardrobe and you pick a model and this is the general vibe. Mm-hmm. Now go do your thing. Because they've seen what I do when I just go do my thing. And so that's worked out really well. In fact, I had a client recently, My Magic Mud, and they're a skincare company. Okay. And they came with a full-on shot list that we were working through. And I just wasn't feeling the vibe, and I didn't feel the photographs that I was capturing based upon the mood board were really telling the story of the brand. Mm-hmm. And so I finally pulled the creative director aside and we went and talked through it. And I said, can you just for a moment on this, I have your shots. I've got a different vision. Can you let me just do my thing and then let's see what we like. And so I went and did my thing and my interpretation of the product in that environment. Mm-hmm. And we came back and we reviewed them and then they kind of laughed and they're like, okay, from here on out, you do your thing. Just do your thing. Execute and go. And I've done this long enough that I start to see and I get when people have an idea of the concept and where they want a brand to go. And so I like it when there's that freedom. However, I don't always want that responsibility. So it depends on the client.
Right. Okay. So now we're looking at, do you see it on your screen here?
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's Demi again.
Oh, it is. I didn't recognize her here. Like she's that was early on.
That was early on with her, and that was purely so one of the things that I do, in addition to doing product photography, which I've done just the simple shots on seamless backdrops, mm-hmm. And such, one of the things also I do besides boutiques and all is I do agency photography. And so I've shot with models out of Page Parks and Campbell and Dragonfly Agency and Mazza and so on. And so that picture you had of Demi, mm-hmm. was a studio shoot for the Mazza model team, just purely doing portfolio building for her girls.
Okay. So All right. So, what about, let's see here. What about this one right here?
That was for the Dragonfly Agency again. And that is a young model that is based out of San Antonio. And so Dragonfly Agency reached out to me and said, once again, she needs a portfolio refresh. They sent me a mood board and said, go execute and build out a new portfolio for her. And so that's what that was.
Yeah, I love the background.
That is at the Pearl in San Antonio. And so she and I wandered around the Pearl. Uh-huh. And grabbed a bunch of photographs, and that caught my attention was that background.
Are you using available light here?
I am using available light for that shot. And it was, you know, one of the things too that's interesting with what I do, she is, I think in that photograph, she's 15. So mm-hmm. her mom and dad were with me, which is always fun because I usually put the dad to work. So I'll grab my reflector and my bounce and hand it to the dad and say, I'll tell you what to do with it when I need help.
Right.
So it gets them involved, which is fun.
Good. All right. Let's go to another one here. So this is, let me guess, that's Demi again.
It is not. That is Carly. Ah.
All right. So this one you've shot, and it's obviously there's some motion blur in it. You've either in camera, you moved the camera, or you played it in Photoshop or something. But you've told me you don't really like to do tons of Photoshop work, right?
I do not. I am not a fan of Photoshop. I will use Photoshop to take out blemishes. Maybe there's a wrinkle in the clothes or a spot or something we didn't catch. But, like I said, blemishes or some obvious things that need to be taken off. But I do not like to go in and change a person's complexion and make them look way different than what they are. That is just something that I do not like to do at all.
Now, stop.
Sorry.
That just goes against everything that I know about fashion photography. So you're supposed to make these people look like porcelain dolls, you know, and I mean, I'm kidding, but that's what people, all these people I see when I see fashion photographers, a lot of times they're so heavily Photoshopped and their skin has been touched up and everything. Is that the photographer who does that, or is that the art director? I mean, is that the people at the magazine or where? I mean, what, and why do you not like to do that?
So to answer the question, it depends. When you are doing like fashion photography, there's a couple of different types of fashion photography that you get involved in.
Okay.
So there's the whole beauty photography industry, and there are people that specialize in that, and that is where it's very heavily retouched. Lots of makeup, lots of conceptual type makeup.
Like if
work
you're selling L'Oreal or something like that, right? In other words, if you're going to sell a skincare product, then you want your skin to be blemish free and everything. Okay, go ahead.
Right, and there's a whole style of the type of photography just called beauty photography in general. Forget if you're promoting a brand or not. Oh. It's just about creating these amazing, well lit, more high key type images that are just, you know, smoothed out skin, flawless, and it's all focused on the makeup and the color. Like there's a photographer here in Austin, Jay Brands is her name, and she's really good at that. I mean, she's some stunning work. But it's very heavily produced what that type of photography is.
Right. Hold on, Todd. I'm sorry. Maybe I'm just too old here. I don't understand. beauty photography, who's the client? I mean, what are you selling in beauty photography? I mean, I understand because we said, oh, if I've got L'Oreal as a client, I'm gonna sell, you know, L'Oreal, and so I want their skin to be perfect and everything. So, but what is who? Tell me this beauty photography.
Okay.
Where's the money? I don't understand it.
So, there's a couple of things. So, some people specialize in beauty photography and like to go out and create these portraits, and most of those are shot from roughly, you know, mid chest up, and it's really more of a headshot style. Because it's all about the makeup and the face and the hair. Now, you can take that in your portfolio and use that to land gigs for shooting L'Oreal and Revlon or Bobbi Brown or pick your makeup design you want. Eyelashes, things like that. Those are all part of that you can build out that portfolio for it.
All right. So I'm understanding. So this beauty photographer is essentially shooting people's portfolios and things like this, or even pitching to magazines, things like this. And then they take that and then hopefully they'll get clients out of that kind of thing. All right. We've got Todd Ramirez says Todd was ahead of his curve with the natural look. So apparently there's a curve with natural look. Is that a trend right now that's going on?
There is, and you'll, if you look right now, and when you look on TV commercials and out in the industry, is it's really about the natural look of someone. There's not the photoshopping. There's not the I don't even know what the tools are called in Photoshop because I don't use them that much, where you can change someone's figure and pull in the waist and right. and change the hips and so on and so forth. And I forget what that's called.
Liquify.
I don't know. Yes, that's it. I don't know anything about doing that stuff. It's foreign to me because I'm really about a person as beautiful as they are. Let's shoot them and let's capture that beauty. And okay. and that's what I specialize in.
However, and I'm not trying to be confrontational here, but okay. Lord knows I mean you're a friend, but I wanna also say at the same time, like this is heavily processed. But you shot this in slide film or something. I mean, what's the it has that whole
that actually,
that transparency feel to it.
So that was actually shot on film that I believe was on Velvia 100 slide film on a 35
okay.
millimeter.
Well, that's what it looks like.
Yeah.
Okay.
Expired but, too. I have a whole case of expired film that I love to shoot with.
Which is
for that.
See, this is so funny because I would have said, oh, come on, you just put this into Photoshop and or Lightroom and used a filter on it and you got that look. But that is the film. So,
mm-hmm.
cool. All right. What's the any story on this one? Wait, go ahead. What?
Yeah. So there's two things that I want to go back and just kind of mention with the mm-hmm. photography. I love shooting just people as they are and natural. And like I said, I will go in and do a little bit of retouching if mm-hmm. I need to. Mm-hmm. Somebody had a bad day. Somebody, maybe recently I had a model that burned their neck with a curling iron in the process of getting ready. And I had to go in and Photoshop and
every
take that
photo.
Out on every single shot. So, you know, I go and I do that. And sometimes if I need to, we're in Texas. I mean, if there's a bunch of sweat that I got to go in and take care of, I'll do that if need be. I'd rather not. That's why I have a team with me. So I do have a makeup person. Usually it's a person named Elizabeth Mickelherron that's with me doing the makeup and stuff. And she runs around with the little blotters and we're blotting before we shoot and making sure that we have what we need. It's not too much shine and matte finish and all of that going on.
Okay, actually, that brings up another question. So mm-hmm. as someone who is not a fashion photographer, never even stuck my foot in the waters, when you go to shoot something like this, you said you have a team with you. What? How big is your team usually, and who pays the team? Do you do that out of your earnings, or does the client pay it?
Most of the time, the client will pay. I would say 90% of the time, the client will pay. So when a client comes to me and they want to do a photo shoot, take for instance the Boutique Castillo. They come to me and they say, we want to create a lookbook. We're going to shoot 12 different outfits, and we want to have one model.
Wait,
and I want
what's
to
a lookbook? Like, remember, we're not in the business. Book. You're using jargon
right.
here.
So a lookbook, it's kind of like what you get if you get in the mail, a catalog, a lookbook that's the collection for Anthropology or Free People or something, and they're introducing the new line for that season.
Okay.
So I'll do that with Astio. And so she may have 10, 12 different things that she wants to have shot. And so she will tell me her concept, the general vibe that she wants. She'll show me all the wardrobe. And then we bring in a hair and makeup person that'll come in. And usually it's the same person. I like to keep a team kind of light because if I'm running through the streets of Austin shooting, I don't want to have a ton of people out there with me. Just I want less distraction and such.
Then? You got a makeup person. You got the photographer.
So I've got
a
hair
grip.
I've got a hair and makeup person. I've got a stylist that's all responsible for the wardrobe. And then I will have an assistant with me.
Who will work as your grip, so to speak, holding up the lights
mm-hmm.
or getting them right in the right. Okay. All right.
Lights, bounces, grab an extra battery, swap a card, change a lens, whatever it might be.
All right. Do you have to get special permission to shoot in like Austin, downtown Austin, places like that?
If I'm not dropping sticks, then no. If it's run and gun, I'm good to go. Unless I cross into certain areas that are like private property. If we're just shooting South Congress, 6th Street, and so on, but there are certain areas that there's like a little food court area downtown in Austin. If I start going down the stairs to that area, even though it's got like a little public outdoor park area, I've crossed into private property, and so I can't shoot there. The Domain is a great shopping area that I love to shoot at, but you have to call the Domain and get permission to shoot there. So it just depends on where. And so I've got a running list of places I know I have to clear before I go.
I like the Domain. Used to mm-hmm. go there all the time for the hat shop and bought my couple of yep. fedoras there, but they closed. Bummer.
And you'd be very surprised how a lot of parks and if city and state parks are totally fine if you go in and do photo shoots and you just pay the park entrance fee. And there's not a big hassle that you have to go through. I shot at the state park near Austin. It was $50. People pay their typical $5, whatever it is, entrance fee, and I paid $50 to do photography and took a whole crew in there with me and shot an entire lookbook there with no issues.
You alluded to the fact that if you drop your sticks, you get trouble. So if you take a tripod into some places, that's the issue.
If I'm downtown in Austin and I start putting down sticks, cops can come around, they'll start questioning because I don't have a permit, especially because I do a lot of video. And so that's where it can get a little funky.
Okay. Well, we're going to get to your video in a second, but let's we're not, there's no way we're going to get through all these pictures because there's just too many really good ones here. So, something froze on me. Here we go. Having some technical issues here. Hold on.
Okay.
There we go. All right. Now let me get back over here. There we go. All right. Oh, I like this. What's the story here? And was this also shot in film, or how'd you get this look?
That was shot on film, and that was at a place called the Secret Theater. It's a little venue down in East Austin area. That is actually inside.
Looks like a trailer.
Well, what it is it's inside of an old school bus that the guy that owns that place gutted out an old school bus and threw down some carpets and a couple of benches and chairs in there. And so you can go inside and shoot. And it's just got unique light coming through and so on. So I shot that on film. That's a friend. Her name is Rose. She's now an artist and has moved out of Austin and does a lot of great, really cool artwork. And I've just always wanted to shoot with Rose. Like, she was one of the first models I shot with back when I first started. And so we pulled some wardrobe from a boutique and we shot together. That was purely just for fun. That was literally just, I've got an idea. I've got a location. I've got some cool wardrobe. Let's go create. And it goes back to that what if and keeping that creative edge going. I love shooting for my clients, but you still have to go out and try and flex that creative muscle and keep the skill going and the craft going.
Now, you said you got the wardrobe from some boutique somewhere? Like,
yes.
I'm assuming when you say boutique, like some shop in the Domain or whatever, you walk in, you say, hey, I'm going to do this photo mm-hmm. shoot. Can one of your people come out and let us use some of your clothing and stuff? And then what do they get out of it?
They get images out of it.
Okay.
Which has been interesting because that's how I've actually ended up getting a lot of clients is by going in. And so that this particular boutique and this was shot quite a few years ago, I say 3-4 years ago. That was for a boutique called Planet Blue. And I went to their store at the Domain when they were there and walked in, introduced myself, and showed them a few of my portfolio pictures and said, could I borrow some wardrobe to go shoot? And in turn, you guys can get some photos, but I would just like some cool clothes to use for the photo shoot. And they were like, absolutely. I gave them a credit card to put on hold for the merchandise. And then I took off and went and shot and then brought the clothing back.
Oh, that's, I never thought about giving them a credit card like that. That's a good idea.
You know, and you asked me earlier about with makeup and things, does the client pay for it? One of the things that I do, and I try to respect the time of some of the people that I work with. And so I've got a makeup artist, and she's a single mom, and she does a lot of my commercial work, but I also like to use her just for fun shoots as well. But I've negotiated with makeup artists that I will always pay them a kit fee. So I may not pay them their full rate. It's up to them. If they ask me to pay a full rate, then I can choose not to. But I've negotiated a kit fee. So at least it replaces the supplies in their kit. And so if I need makeup for a particular fun editorial that I'm going to do, like this one with Demi that you're looking at here, then I will pay them a small fee and they agree to do that. And then everyone gets pictures.
Interesting. Well, can I ask a question? What does a kit fee run?
When you different makeup artists are will have different rates, but on the average, it's $50.
Okay. So that's what they come. All of these makeup artists, they know this. This is an industry standard kind of a thing, a kit fee, huh? These are terms I've never even
heard
of.
Yes, it is. And some makeup artists will charge that, some won't. It really just depends. But I know, like with Elizabeth that I work with, and I know mm-hmm. her situation, and so I have no problem working in that rate with her. And I've got like two others that I do the same thing with. They have a kit fee, and I call upon them to do makeup, and it works out great. Because, I mean, obviously, I can't do makeup, so.
Although I was going to say, you've probably surprised your wife now when you come home and you go, oh, you've got that Eve Arden outfit from 1997 or whatever, you know. Yeah.
You know what's funny, just on the side note for something fun, because we're in this quarantine thing. The salon here in Georgetown was selling root touch-up kits that you could buy to touch up the roots for hair. Mm-hmm. And so last week, my fun project was that I touched up my wife's roots for her, which was fun.
Oh, so now you're becoming a makeup artist. So. Great.
All right, fun.
So who is this?
All right, so this is Callie Heard. Callie Heard is a model that splits her time between Miami and also does work in Chile. And I met Callie a few years ago, and she lives in Austin. That's where her home is, but she travels and shoots in different locations. At the time we met, I think she was with IMG Models or Elite Model. I think it was Elite, maybe. Anyway, I met with Callie, and so she's able to do work in Austin that does not have to run through the agency. And it's because it's her home, it's her off time, because her main representation was in those two other cities. So I reached out to Callie and asked her to shoot for Estilo Boutique in Austin. And so she's been the model for Estilo Boutique for probably 2.5 years now. And this was on one of our spring lookbook shoots that we did. We shot this down at Mayfield Park in Austin.
Very cool.
And this is one of those lookbooks for the boutique.
I love this shot.
Yeah, it's great. It's a fun shot. That is a model named, her name is Shaterica. She lives up in New York City. I do not remember the agency that she's with, but we did a shoot together. We pulled wardrobe from a store called Brazos Market, and that wardrobe that's there is from Free People. And she was fixing to move to New York. And so she and I did a quick portfolio refresh shoot together for her agency's work.
I love that whole look, and I love the light on this, the backlit. It's just, oh yeah, that's just fun.
Yeah. You know, it's natural light. I didn't add anything to that. Right. That was just, you know, as we know, the dynamic range on our cameras today is just phenomenal to take something like this and work with it.
Well, I'm surprised you're not shooting a like a Fuji GFX or, you know, I know you're a Lumix ambassador, but you know, with the GFX, you've got that massive sensor on it and 50 megapixels or even 100 megapixel one, which gives you even more dynamic range. So I guess I'm pitching you from one brand ambassador to another here.
Yes, you are.
No pressure.
No pressure.
No. Anyway, yeah. So anyway, but that's the dynamic range is what I was actually looking at on this. Is so nice. Mm-hmm. Is this recent, or when was this taken?
This was taken probably a year ago, roughly. About a year ago.
So was this with the Lumix?
That was with the S1R, I believe.
Okay. Carly Golden Bones. What in the world is that?
So Golden Bones was a boutique here in Austin. They're no longer business. The owners have moved on to other projects. But that was a shoot in studio with Carly for some of their products, for social media and for a lookbook. And that was with a purse that they had, along with some different tops and stuff. And so we grabbed a bunch of wardrobe and shot a quick lookbook for them.
That's barely a top. So actually I want to, so on your website, you don't really have any nudes, and then, which is interesting for a fashion photographer, because I always seem to see that. And yet you do have a couple with sheer tops like this, but you've got, like, I'm assuming that's like a sensor line going through it, or is that fashion? Okay.
No,
so
that's a sensor line going through that.
Okay, why do you censor it on your own website? I understand for Facebook, but and actually we probably would have had to do this for Facebook anyway. So good timing. But why do you told me, and we were talking about this, why I thought it was interesting.
I don't shoot nudes. Obviously, that's not my thing. That's not what I do. And there are times when some designers and some boutiques have tops like this, or there's been some designers that have had wardrobe walk the runway. I mean, and that's their design. It is what they do. It's their art that they created. And so if that comes into the mix of what I shoot, I will shoot that for them. That's what I'm hired to do. And then for me, though, if I'm going to put that out in my portfolio where it shows up, then I'm going to censor that, because I have a broad range of clients that I work with that run the gamut from, you know, more conservative boutiques to designers that are a little bit more edgy to, I still to this day do some senior shoots as well in and around the Georgetown area. And so I'm just respectful of that. And so that's why I censor that, that work. And you know, once again, I've got different portfolios. So typically this is out of my fashion portfolio, which a lot of people just wouldn't normally stumble upon and see.
I like it anyway. It's cool. And the fact that the way you did it, I actually thought it was a part of the whole, you know, tease kind of picture thing you had going on there. So, all right. Is this Carly as well?
That's Carly as well. And that was a wardrobe from Golden Bones again. And we just switched it up just with the whole button-up shirt. And, you know, and all of this is single light work. This is a Savage seamless backdrop that I use. And for my big studio lights, when I'm shooting like e-commerce work, I use a Profoto D2 with a huge 7-foot parabolic umbrella. And then on set type running around downtown kind of thing, if I put up a light, I use a Westcott FJ400 light.
Which is what I was going to ask. Your timing is perfect. I was just going to ask you what is it that you actually do? What kind of kit do you actually take on the field with you? So you gave us the lights. What do you do as far as the camera and anything else in the field? What do you use?
So when I'm in the field shooting, depending upon the use of the photo, if that photo is going to go to print or anything larger, then I'll use the Lumix S1R will be the camera, and that's the 47 megapixel camera. So I'll shoot with that camera out in the field. If it's going to mainly go with maybe a print size that's smaller, maybe an 8x10 for a countertop or in the store window or social media, then I'll shoot with the S1, which is 24 megapixel camera.
Okay. And then and the light kit's lenses. The same as your, that's going to be different than what you do in a studio. What are you taking on the field with you?
Right. And then I'll just hit lenses real quick. I shoot with a 24-72.8, and that's just the workhorse, bread and butter for most photographers. And then also I love a good 51-4 is fantastic for shots. And then I love the look of a 35-1.4 as well. And so Sigma has a series of art lenses out that are L-mount for the Lumix system that I love. And they've sent me a bunch of lenses to play with, and so I settled on a 35-1.4 that I love for that kit. Shooting for the lighting and such, if I'm doing just natural light, not bringing any kit along, obviously I'm using a 5-in-1 reflector, and we'll use that. But if I'm going to use lights outdoors, then depending upon how much of the sun I need to overpower or where I'm shooting, how small it is, the area, I have a Godox AD200 that I carry with me mm-hmm. for small. And then I also have the Westcott FJ400. And then I will use both of them are Bowens mount. So I use the Westcott line, the Rapid Box series of the modifiers. And so I carry the medium and the large with me, as well as I think it's the Joel Grimes beauty dish that they make as well. And those are the main modifiers that I use. And like I said, if I'm in studio for e-commerce, it's a Profoto D2 with a big 7-foot parabolic. Okay. But I'm really big on one light. That's what I love.
Yeah, me too. Keep it simple. Have you ever used the SMDVs? Those are the super quick to set up. You just click, 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 and they're up. You don't take them apart. You don't have to put any rods in. It's no umbrella thing to it, so you can actually leave the reflector or the diffuser in. You can even leave a grid on it, and then just fold it all up, and then literally pop it up.
I've not used those. I've got where my rapid box system is very simple. I don't take everything apart. I literally peel apart one side, stick my hand in, pop the umbrella, fold it up, and go.
Okay.
So I'm not having to reassemble it.
All right. So Joe Ramirez says, speaking of, what's Todd's current Lumix setup?
Okay. So if you're referring to the one that I'm using right now for us talking, doing the live streaming, I actually just switched because I'm using it for a client gig. I was using the S1H for the live streaming stuff, but right now I'm on a GH5 with the 12-62.8 lens on this. And then I'm feeding that into a video capture card. And then the monitor for myself, I'm using an Atomos Shinobi as my monitor.
There you go.
Lighting over here, this constant light is an aperture 120D for the light.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know if he was talking about your streaming setup or if he was talking about just your current kit in the field these days, but I think we've already answered that anyway. So
the field kit is always the S1R and the S1. Those are my two main. And if I'm shooting heavy on the video, then it's the S1 and the S1H.
All right. Hey, I've skipped through some of these photos, and I've come up to Trish here. We're gonna throw her up on the screen, and then we're gonna do some work on your videos. We're gonna look at that. But here's Trish. I really like these shots of her, and for many reasons. One, I think she's really pretty. Two, she's also I think it's fair to say mature.
She is. Trish is in her 50s when I shot with Trish. She was in her 50s. Okay. And it was funny how I found Trish. So the client that I shot with is for King & Rose Optical. They're a high-end eyewear shop in Austin. And I was just King & Rose had called me, and we did it. We had a series of photo shoots that we were going to do. And one of the things that we had talked about was finding a mature model for the shoot, just to appeal and just for their clientele. So I was thumbing through Instagram, and all of a sudden I came across this photo of Trish, and she had just had her hair cut short like this by a hair designer friend of mine. And I immediately, when I saw Trish's photo, I texted my friend and I was like, who is this lady? I need to get a hold of her. I need to do a photo shoot. And Trish had not modeled, was not even on her radar whatsoever at all. And so she agreed to do a conversation with me. So I called her and I said, Trish, you are absolutely gorgeous. You're what I'm looking for the shoot. Love the hair and everything. I'll get makeup and hair done. We'll get wardrobe. And I'd love to have you as a part of the shoot. So she agreed and we had a blast. And she and I have done probably three projects together. We've done a few with King and Rose. And then I hired her to do a video project for me as well.
Yeah, these are great. I don't know if I have one more or not. Oh, well, let's tell you what, let me come back to you.
That's got a fun little technique on that.
Go back to it. Go ahead. What's the, oh yeah, you're shooting through, is that, are you shooting through your fingers there? What is that?
I am not. So that particular photo, that's a girl named Jane, and she lives in LA, and she used to live in the Austin area, and it was getting to be really, it was getting dusk at that point, and I wanted to add just some texture and color to this photo, and so I did not do this in post-production at all. I grabbed a little Savage RGB 300, so Savage that makes the backdrops also makes a series of small lights. Mm-hmm. So I grabbed the Savage RGB 300, set it to orange, and I actually held that up to the lens, right next to the lens, and let it just cast that light right across that lens and shot that photo.
So you created light leak.
I did. I created a light leak.
Very good. Excellent. Okay, so I'm gonna jump over. We've gone over an hour here, so I want to definitely make sure that we touch into some of your video stuff. So I'm gonna play a couple of these, and then let's see what we get here. I'll make sure I'm on the right one here. Okay, here we go. This is the cheese. Okay, so that was the cheese bread that we looked at just then.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Todd is at a disadvantage because he can't see what I'm playing there because we're talking on Skype and that feed isn't going into your Skype. So so that was the cheese bread one. Can you give me a backstory on that?
So 600 Degrees is a pizza place here in Georgetown where I live, and they're a client of mine. And so they had opened up a brand new marketplace that was separate from the pizza place. And they were launching this new cheese bread that they had not done before at the pizza place. And so I was in there one day, and Jerry, the chef and owner of the marketplace part, was making some cheese bread. And I had my camera, and he said, I'm fixing to make the cheese bread. You want to get a couple of photos? And I said, let's get some video of this done. So I had my S1 in the car. So I grabbed that with a 24-70 and shot that. All of that was handheld shot for that particular sequence.
Cool. Okay. So now we're going to look at Alyssa. Is that
okay?
Ring a bell? Okay. Here we go.
Alyssa. Mm-hmm.
All right, so that was Alyssa, and what's the is that just a role for her? Is that it that you're shooting that for her?
That's a role for her. It was also some stuff that I was shooting with Lumix, just showing the S1 camera and what it can do and about how it grades. Is that the one with Alyssa that had a bunch of the blurs and light leaks going on?
Yeah.
Okay, so that one was a fun one. I use a technique called lens whacking to do that. So none of the blurs and the light leaks were done in post-production. All of that was done in camera before I even got it into Premiere for the editing.
Okay.
And so when I shoot that,
what's lens whacking?
I actually take the lens off the camera and just hold it up against the camera. And so I'll set a focal distance. I'll kind of measure off and know, hey, you need to stay this far away from me. And for me to keep the focus roughly, I have focus peaking turned on. And so I'll just hold the lens apart from the camera. And then as I move around and I shoot, I'll just shift it from side to side. And it has a little bit of a tilt shift effect to it. Mm-hmm. Let the light kind of come through. The downside of it is if it's a windy day, you run the risk of getting a dirty sensor. But as you can see, the effect that it does is really cool and it's fun. And it's neat to do it in camera because I can see it happening right there and I can go back and reshoot if I need to.
Okay, I'm going to run this again. It's very short, so I'm going to run it again, let people see that technique that you just talked about again. So here we go. From the lens mount on it. So that was interesting.
Yep.
Okay. Very cool. All right. So one of my favorites, Covet Hats. Backstory on this before we watch it.
They are a client and wanted to have a really cool video of launching one of their new collections. And so the model there is Madison. The wardrobe we pulled. This is one of those fun little collaboration efforts here. Clients covet the hats. Madison was a model visiting from Oklahoma that I had shot for a different client who happened to be in town, hired her for this, used Elizabeth, and then we pulled wardrobe from my other client, Estio Boutique. So it's kind of fun. Once again, it's all about that networking and developing those relationships that you can then use and then, you know, use for different jobs and opportunities. And so this was us getting together with roughly 2 hours to run through a lot of hats, and we shot this down in Austin.
Okay, cool. Let's
and it's all handheld.
All right, all handheld. Here we go. Nice. So I got to ask you though, are they doing, do these guys covet hats? Do they do men's hats or only women's hats? Next time in Austin, I go by.
Right. She does custom hats. So you can definitely get one for men.
Yep. Okay. All right. Probably out of my price range, but all right. Very cool. All right. I think that's gonna wind it up. Is there anything that we haven't talked about that you want to make sure we talk about, Todd?
You know, I think just with photographers, I think for me in making that big jump, it's really going all in and not being afraid to put yourself out there and to make those connections and to continue to learn along the way. There was a big learning curve going from photo to video because right now I'm like 50-50 on my business between photo and video. And so it's always staying current, always pushing, and always, you know, not saying no to jobs, especially if you can learn those jobs in the time before you have to shoot that job, which I've done before.
Okay. All right, before we close, Joe Ramirez has a question. He's saying, he says, what's the story with Live a Great Story? Your t-shirt and hat.
This is a brand in the Austin area. A buddy of mine, Zach, runs this. And it's just really, he really encourages people to to live a great story, to find your purpose in life, to find what you want to go after, and then go for it and make that happen. And to really turn life into an adventure, not to be a slave to like the corporate stuff and the things that drag you down, but to really embrace life and the things that you love, what you have a passion for, and then go after it and chase that. And I just like it's the meaning behind it for sure.
Yeah. Okay. So, hey, in closing, I want to pull up your contact information. So here we go. This is how you can find Todd. You go to toddwhite.myportfolio.com. And then also on Instagram, which I said he's super, super active on Instagram. So go to Instagram.com, Todd White. Again, they're right there on the screen, so definitely go by and visit him. Give him a thumbs up, give him a like, give him a follow. Do all the above on Instagram. And then, of course, he's on Facebook as well. And in closing, that will tell you how to subscribe. I mean, tell you how to download your ebook, and everything's cool. So, Todd, thanks again so much.
Thanks so much
for being with us. Appreciate your time.
Appreciate it.
I know it's getting on about 10 o'clock there. No, it's 8 o'clock, I guess, there in the evening.
Yeah, 8:15.
8:15. Yeah. So, time to go out and get a cigar or a pipe and a brew and enjoy yourself.
Yep.
I've yet to meet your wife, but tell your wife hello for me. And you have kids?
I have a daughter and I actually have a granddaughter.
Get out of here.
I do. So my wife is older than I am. So I've got a daughter and I have a 9-year-old granddaughter. Yep.
Wow.
Which is wonderful, and she is an artist, so she's responsible for that tattoo right there.
Oh wow! So she drew the tattoo, and then
she did when she realized that these crayons, as she called them, don't ever come off. She asked if she could draw for me, and I told her absolutely, and she drew that, and that was what she wanted for her 6th birthday, was to have a tattoo that she drew, and then I've got one more that I'm waiting for this whole Corona thing to be done. And I've got another one that she drew to get over on this arm as well.
So you took the design over to the tattoo artist, and then they did it over onto your arm. Very cool. Yeah, I don't have any tats yet. I've been talking about it, but can't bring myself to it quite. Actually, I don't have anything I want on my arm that I will want for the rest of my
life.
It's
a commitment.
Yeah,
a commitment.
It is a commitment. So anyway, hey, great talking with you. And again,
thanks, man.
Thank you for your time. And we've lost audio. They said, I don't know. I'm looking like we have audio. I don't know what the problem is. Hope that's just happened. But
testing one.
Yeah, no, I'm showing we have audio going out. So hopefully it was just John's audio that we lost. But anyway, that's going to do it for us. Thanks so much. Again, coming up.
Thank you.
Yeah, coming up very soon in. Let me get to the right screen here. Coming up next this Wednesday, I will be speaking with an old friend of mine, Pete Vandenade, and we will be talking about Ethiopia. We're talking about travel photography. We're talking about Fuji film. We're talking about lights. We're going to talk about all kinds of stuff. He's going to do some Lightroom work for us. So that's coming up Wednesday. It's going to be a different time. It's going to be in the evening here in Malaysia, and it's going to be sometime in probably the afternoon, early afternoon in Europe. So that'll be on Facebook. And if you're interested in knowing when all these are happening, everything, subscribe to Digital Trekker Facebook. Also subscribe to my email, because I send out all kinds of stuff there as well about all this. Again, thanks to our special guest, Todd White, and go check out his stuff. Thanks so much. Talk to you soon.